My name is Claire Pooley, and I am the author of the book The Sober Diaries and the blog Mummy Was a Secret Drinker. And I am so pleased to be here on Club Soda because it's such a fabulously welcoming and life-changing community, and it's great to be here, and thank you for listening. So 3 days ago, it was my 3-year soberversary, and I can't quite believe I've got this far, but it seems like a really appropriate time to be talking to you guys about those first few years sober and how it's changed my life. And what I thought I would do is talk about those first early weeks and months, but then also talk about how the benefits of going sober just keep coming. And I thought initially when I quit drinking that the changes would happen very quickly. And what I didn't realize is that 2 years, even 3 years down the line, life keeps changing and life keeps getting better. And so I thought that might be a helpful thing to share with you. And I know that this is only my story, but I have had hundreds of messages and emails from people all over the world who have told me their stories. And what's amazing is that we are all very different. We live in different countries, we're different ages, we come from different backgrounds. And yet the experience of addiction and getting over addiction is so similar for all of us. It really binds us together. And so my story, I hope, will be helpful for all of you too. So 3 years ago, I was in a very different place from where I am now. And I was drinking a bottle of wine a day, and I was probably more at weekends. So if you add it all up, I was drinking about 10 bottles of wine a week, which is, even I realized, way more than the government guidelines. And so that was having a major impact on pretty much everything in my life. I was a terrible insomniac. I was anxious all the time. I was 2 stone overweight, and I had this terrible wine belly. So I couldn't actually see my feet when I looked down, and people used to offer me their seats on buses, and it was really embarrassing. And I felt like I was a really bad mother as well, because I had given up work to spend more time with my children, and then I felt like I was spending the whole time running away from them. So I would wrap up bedtime stories really early so I could get downstairs and have a glass of wine. And I felt like I was on a different wavelength from them quite a lot of the time. And I was grumpy and distracted, and you know, and I really started not liking myself very much. So I realized that something had to change. And you know what? A lot of people have asked me over the last few months, why was it that this time I managed to quit for good when I had tried and failed so many times before? And believe me, I really had. So, you know, if you keep falling off the wagon, don't despair. One day you will get there. For me, there were three things that really made the difference this time around. And the first was realizing that moderation was never going to work for me. And I think you have to know that deep down, because if you're not absolutely convinced that you can't moderate, it's very, very hard, because as soon as things get tricky, the wine witch starts jabbering and saying, oh, now you've given up for a while, you've recalibrated, and you can drink moderately just like a normal person. And it's really, really seductive. So it's quite important to go into the whole thing knowing that that isn't an option, if indeed it isn't an option. And I had tried and tried and tried to moderate. I set myself all sorts of, you know, rules, and I would say, I'm not going to drink during the week, I'm not going to drink at home, I'm only going to drink beer because I don't really like beer. And all the time I would break those rules. I'd manage for a few days or maybe even a week or two, and then I'd be back to where I started, which was terrible for my self-esteem because I really started hating myself. And it became obvious to me that I was never going to be able to moderate, that I'm very much an all or nothing person, and moderation just isn't in my nature. And as soon as I realized that, it became obvious that actually giving up altogether was going to be easier for me than just constantly trying to keep a lid on it. So that was a big revelation, and that really helped in the time that followed. The second thing that I think made the big difference is community. And in the old days, the only real option was Alcoholics Anonymous. Whereas now, there are hundreds of different options out there, and Club Soda is such an amazing resource and wasn't there, sadly, when I first quit drinking. But having a community really helps. And for me, my community was the blog that I set up, Mummy Was a Secret Drinker. And that community of people all over the world, all going through the same thing as me at the same time, was really helpful. So it made me feel less alone. It's so easy to feel like you're the only person in the world going through this, and not feeling alone is such a joy. And it meant that, whenever I was struggling, I would feel like I couldn't possibly let down all those other people that I was on this journey with. And there were people, there to give me advice whenever I found things tough. So if I was at a party and I was finding things really difficult, I would literally escape to the loo, and I'd sit on the loo with my phone, and I would look up my blog, and I would talk to people and say, what do I do? And so community is crucial, and Club Soda is absolutely, fabulous in providing that. So that was the second thing. And then the third thing I think really made the difference is becoming excited about quitting rather than fearing it. And in the past, I'd always been really scared about the idea of giving up drinking. I thought my life would be over, and I would never ever have fun again, and I'd lose all my friends, and it was all going to be disastrous. And what made the difference for me was reading Jason Vale's book, Kick the Drink Easily. And it was like a light bulb moment. It just made me completely rethink the way that that I viewed alcohol. And there are other books that do the same thing. Alan Carr, his book does the same sort of thing, as does Annie Grace's book, The Naked Mind, This Naked Mind. So if you haven't read one of those already, I really would do, because for me and for many people, it just helps switch the way you think about alcohol. And if you can be excited and not scared, then that makes all the difference in the world. So those were the three things that changed for me this time going into it. And then I thought I'd talk a bit about those early days and what it's like. And I'm sure many of you have been through this or are going through it right now. The first few weeks for me was pretty much like having flu. I had terrible headache. I was exhausted all the time. So if any of you are there feeling really knackered, if that's par for the course, I felt sort of shivery and a bit sweaty, and I just couldn't think about anything other than alcohol. And my I felt very like walking through fog or like walking through treacle. I couldn't really concentrate very well. And that, that period lasted for about 2 or 3 weeks. And I found what really helped getting through that, and what I always tell people now, is that if you can just be incredibly good to yourself, go to bed early with a great book, make hot chocolate, eat cake, worry about the weight later. Just I found cake incredibly helpful, and just you're doing an incredible thing, and you really deserve you deserve to be good to yourself. Give yourself some treats, buy something nice, and just don't give yourself a hard time about anything. Change anything you think you might find difficult in that period, just avoid it. And then the next big milestone most people find is at about 100 days, so 3 months or 100 days in. Until that point, it can be quite tough going. And I found that initially the wine witch got more and more and more insistent. So I was constantly thinking about drinking and not drinking. And I was I spent my whole time reading about it and writing about it. it became a total obsession. And the other thing about those first 100 days is emotions, dealing with emotions. I'm sure we've come across this, but we spend years and years sort of using alcohol as a way of numbing all of those nasty, pesky emotions like anxiety and fear and and boredom and stress and everything. And then, when you stop drinking, you have to deal with all of those things raw, and that's really hard. And it takes a long time to get used to that. I did a lot of weeping, I'm sure, and actually weeping is really therapeutic. And I felt like that period was very much about breaking yourself down and then building yourself up again, brick by brick. And it is tough. And the tools that I use to get through those first 100 days, and I know a lot of other people do as well, is firstly great non-alcoholic drinks. So giving yourself an adult drink at the end of the day that makes you feel like you're able to relax really helps. So if you've read my book, you'll know that I was obsessed by Beck's Blue. And at the time, that was one of the only adult alcohol-free drinks available. And for me, it was really helpful because I wasn't a beer drinker. So Beck's Blue wasn't too close to my poison of choice, which was wine. I couldn't touch alcohol-free wine for a very long time because it was too sort of triggery for me. But Beck's Blue really hit the spot. And if you can find something that does that for you, that's really helpful. So this is my new thing. This is a Seedlip and tonic. And that's what I drink about this time every evening. And I find that, it just helps me relax. So a good alcohol-free drink really helps. Cake, as I said, hot baths, yoga, running, cleaning. I mean, in the early days, I spent a lot of time cleaning because it keeps your hands busy, keeps you occupied, and it just stops you thinking about drinking. Blogging was really helpful for me. Reading and writing really helped. So I think the key thing is to find something that will keep your hands and your mind occupied and stop you thinking about booze at that crucial point of the day, the sort of wine o'clock time. The other thing, of course, is community. So if you're finding wine o'clock tricky, then then go on to Club Soda, talk to people. There will be other people going through exactly the same thing as you at exactly the same time. So talk about it and help each other. And try and stay excited. Try and remember why you're doing this when it gets tough. So I have this vision board, and I pin on it how I want my life to look. And when I quit drinking, I put pictures of what I wanted life sober to look like. So I had pictures of me sort of looking fit and healthy and being a great mom and having more money and being slimmer and more energetic and all those things. And I put that by my bed, and my children call it Mummy's wish board, and every now and again they stick things on it too. So for instance, I find that every now and again there'll be a picture like a yellow Ferrari on it or something, and I thought, how did that get there? Anyway, so put it having a board of what you want your life to look like, I find really useful, and it just helps keep you focused on what it is that that you're doing this for. And by the way, if you gave up at the beginning of January, I don't know if there's anybody listening who's been doing been sober since January the 1st, you're at sort of day 60 something now. And I've had lots of emails from people recently who are suddenly finding it really hard. And if that's you, then that's about the hardest time. So you are not alone. If you're on day 60 something, basically all the excitement has worn off, and you're suddenly thinking, oh God, this is going to go on forever and ever, and you can't see the end, and it hasn't started getting easy yet. It will do. Just keep going. You're doing so well. So if you're at that point, don't stop. Just keep on going. Take it one day at a time. And that sounds like a cliche, but it's so true. Just one day at a time, and you will get there, and it will get easier. So At about 100 days, it started getting much easier for me. So I had less anxiety, I could see my feet again, I had less of a wine belly, I had more energy, and I was a better mother, I was more patient, I was more on the same wavelength as my friends, as my children rather. And I'd even started telling a few friends what I was going through. And by 6 months, I could start thinking about forever and stop thinking about just one day at a time. And I just sort of refound my mojo, and I was able to go to parties and have fun, and everything was going great. And then I got cancer, which was a real bugger, actually. I'm getting emotional just talking about it, but if you read my book, you'll know that I wrote about the day I found the lump I'm in my boob. And what's in the book is what I wrote on that day. So it's very raw and it's very real. And what I learned through that whole experience is that when life throws you lemons, when you are going through tough times, alcohol doesn't help at all, and being sober is just such a gift. And I thank somebody every day that I was sober when that happened to me, because if I'd still been drinking when I discovered that I had cancer, I would have drunk through it. I would have cried in front of the children. I would have gone to pieces. I probably would have ignored the lump for several weeks because I would have convinced myself that it was fine, which I would have been able to do with the false confidence that alcohol gives you. And I may not be alive today because if I'd left it any longer, it would have been a very different picture from the one that it was. So I am so grateful that I was sober then. And what's interesting is that when you go through a trauma in life, the tools that you need to get through it are exactly the same as the tools that you use to get sober. So things like taking it one day at a time, using distractions, using mindfulness, the power of community, all of those things are really helpful, whatever the trauma you're experiencing is. So what I really wanted to do is to say, what you're doing now, however hard you're finding it, will give you superpowers. And when bad things happen in the future, and bad things happen to everybody at some point or other, you will be able to cope in a way that you wouldn't necessarily have been able to before. And I found that after those months of becoming sober, and dealing with emotions without a crutch, made me strong and they made me brave. And I was able to focus on keeping things normal for the children. And whatever hits you in life, whether it's an ill parent or partner or yourself or something with your children, being sober will make you so strong. So if there's no, you're not doing this for any other reason, then think about that. It's funny, we assume that when things get tough, that alcohol will help, and quite the reverse is true. So I ended that first year sober, cancer-free, and I found that I sort of rediscovered the person I used to be. I found that sort of brave, energetic, and funny girl that I was years previously, and I thought I'd lost. And that was an amazing thing. And funny enough, if you follow me on Instagram, you might have seen I posted a picture a couple of days ago of a reunion I had with two old school friends. And there's a picture of us 30 years ago and a picture of us today. And now I feel the same as that girl 30 years ago, whereas I lost her for years. For 2 decades, I felt like I lost who I really was. And the great thing about going sober is you refind the person that you really are. And many people say the same thing, not just me. So year two, which isn't in my book, my book ends at the end of year one. And year two and year three have been incredible for me, and they are as well for many people, because if year one of going sober is about looking inwards and rediscovering who you are and dealing with emotions and all of that sort of stuff, year two and onwards is really about looking outwards again and rediscovering old passions and refinding your creativity. And there are so many people who say that when they're drinking, it's almost like their creativity is being numbed and everything is very sluggish. And when you stop drinking, your brain starts firing in a way that it hasn't for years. And I wrote a book. Other people set up businesses. They go traveling. They find new love. Year two and three can be really miraculous. Once you've sorted yourself out, it opens up so many doors for the future. You have more creativity, as I said, but more so more time and energy and a lack of fear. When you've been through the process of getting sober, it makes you brave, and you realize that outside the comfort zone is where the magic happens, which is, an expression I use quite a lot. That bravery made me want to tell my story, because I realized that people's stories change lives. And Oprah said recently, that speaking your truth is the most powerful tool we all have. And it really is. It makes other people feel less alone and it gives people the courage to change. And I think what a lot of people find in year two and year three, thank you for all your comments, by the way, I am reading them. What a lot of people find in year two and year three is that they want to they no longer want to be anonymous and that they want to tell their story and they want to help other people. And AA's 12th step is all about helping other people following on from you. And that's really what I wanted to do. And I think a lot of people find the same thing, is that actually, once you've done that first year, it is all about helping other people do the same thing. What's fascinating about quitting is that when I was drinking, my world got smaller and smaller and smaller. And since I've quit, it's got bigger and bigger and bigger. And yours will too. Everybody's does. And it's a miraculous thing. And one of the final things I want to say before I come on to questions is that I used to wonder why, several years after they quit drinking, people still went to Alcoholics Anonymous and they still go on communities like Club Soda and blogs like mine, and why they still write blogs sort of years down the line. I thought, surely you want to forget about it all and move on. And actually, I think it's really important because it reminds us why we're here and what we've been through and why it's important not to go back. And it keeps us grounded and it allows us to help other people. So that's why I'm still here, and that's why I hope you'll still be here in a year or 2 years or whenever. And I just wanted to really end by saying that I thought that quitting alcohol would change some things in my life, or rather, I hoped it would change some things in my life. And what I didn't realize is that it would change everything in my life. And it continues to do so for the better. So, if you're still at the coal face and you're still finding it tough, then just keep on going because it's a few tough months in exchange for years and years of a much better life. So I would stay close to Club Soda, find your own toolbox of things to get you through wine o'clock. And focus on the end game, focus on why you're doing this. That's really it from me. I just wanted to see if any of you had any questions you want me to ask. I'll be totally honest about anything you want to ask me. So do go ahead. If anyone's got anything they want to say on here. So I started on January the 1st, still hanging in there, waiting for the light. Sally, go, Sally. You're doing brilliantly. You've done the most tricky bit, and it will get easier. Are you writing another book? I am going to write another book, but I'm going to write fiction, because I think I've done enough of plundering my own life. So I think the next thing I want to do is write a novel. And because I love writing, and that's and being sober has helped me to refine that love of writing. Jeanette says, I don't think I'm finding who I was 30 years ago. I find I'm becoming the person I wanted to be 30 years ago. Yes, yay, go, Jeanette. It is transformative whether you're going back to who you used to be or who you want to be. And well done with day 62. Holidays, any tips for the summer? The first sober holiday is really tough, and then you realize that sober holidays really are just the best, because I think the main thing to do is focus on the morning. Because in the old days when you went on drinking holidays, the evening it would all be about the evenings, wouldn't it? It's all about going out and having lots of drinks, and the mornings were obviously quite a lot of the time were pretty terrible, because you wake up feeling awful and with a terrible hangover, and try and be enthusiastic about being on holiday. And sober holidays are the other way round. Often the evenings are quite quiet, and I often on a sober holiday I'll often go to bed quite early. I wake up feeling amazing and being in a beautiful place, up at dawn and swimming in the sea or whatever, is just the most phenomenal experience. And you come back from a sober holiday feeling properly rested and not just feeling toxic, which is what I used to do on holidays. So they are different, but I think much better. I hope you really enjoy it. Do you still have your best mummy mug? Yes, I do. And I feel like I still feel like I'm not the best mum in the world, but I am much better than I was. How many times did you try and quit? Oh God. I tried to quit for a number of times over a number of years. So I probably had three or four big attempts that went from anything from a few weeks to the longest one was about 2 or 3 months. I managed, and then lots of little attempts. All those giving up on a Friday and starting again by Wednesday or whatever it might be. So yes, lots is the answer, Stephanie. And I think the thing to remember is that if you do keep trying and failing, it's actually not failure. It's just learning. As I said, you really have to learn that moderation isn't going to work for you, if indeed it isn't going to work for you. So don't see it as failure, just see it as all part of the learning process, and just pick yourself up and keep going. What else is here? So Laura on day three, can't find any energy. I know it's exhausting the first 3 days. And you end up back at day one all the time. I don't know if you've read the books that I mentioned, but I think a lot of that is about trying to find that sense of excitement. Because if you don't have at the beginning, if you don't have that sense of energy and excitement about the whole thing, those first few days are really hard. So if you haven't read any of those books, then do. And I would also say, just go to bed really early. In the early days, I went to bed at about 8 p.m. with the children, and we'd all get into bed together. So just sleep a lot, and the mornings, remember, the evenings are hard, the mornings are easy. So have try and get less evening and more morning. Did you see improvements in yourself in the second year? I still. The improvements second year are less physical, because most of the physical changes come in the first year. The improvements in the second year are more about finding a sense of direction, finding out what you want to do with the rest of your life. So it's more of a sort of it's more of an emotional, motivational change, I think, in year two, than it is a physical change. Apart from Seedlip, what other alcohol-free drinks do you like? I'm a big fan of kombucha, which I've only is that how you pronounce it? I've only just discovered that, and I love the fact that actually it's not just fake alcohol. I think the danger is that we see all the drinks that you end up drinking are fake wine or fake gin or fake. So, and kombucha is just an adult, really healthy, really tasty drink that isn't just fake alcohol. So that's another one of my big favorites. I do now drink alcohol-free wine, and I love there's one called Torres Naturejo is my favorite alcohol-free wine, and I drink all sorts of different alcohol-free beers now, not just Beck's Blue. Sober living is all about the mornings, I think. That's Bridie. Yes, I totally agree with you. I just love the mornings now, and I'll never get on a Sunday morning feeling amazing. I think it's about time to wrap up, but let me just see if there's anything else I can answer. I'm only 8 days in and worried about socializing with people I normally drink with. Do you have any tips? I have to confess that in the early days, I didn't tell people I'd stopped drinking, or at least I didn't tell them why. So I would use excuses like I'm driving, or I'm on antibiotics, or I've just given up for a short while, because I didn't want to have to get into all the reasons why I'd quit. And it's up to you whether you think that's a good idea or not. I mean, some people think it's important to be honest right from the beginning, but I didn't want to get into those conversations. So I think the truth is, you don't have to talk about it if you don't want to. And if you're at a party, it sometimes helps just to fake it. So, I would drink just a tonic or something that looked like it was, or an alcohol-free beer, and just not tell people I wasn't drinking alcohol. And I think it's tricky because other people's reactions are often the most difficult thing to deal with. And if people think that you're drinking, they're much more relaxed about you than if they think you're not drinking. So you might find that that is the easiest thing to do initially. I know some of you may disagree and think that, as I said, it's important to be honest up front, but I found actually not talking about it to start with quite helpful until I was really strong and enough to deal with other people's reactions, which I am now, obviously. I don't care what people think now. Cheryl, I think I'm hooked on AF wine, but it's not causing me to want real wine. Should I be concerned? No. When I was going through the whole cancer thing, I drank up to about six bottles of alcohol-free beer every day. And I'm not sure I could have got through that time without that. It was a real prop for me. But it's not addictive. So when things got easier, it naturally scaled down. I stopped. Now I drink, two or three beers a week, alcohol-free beers, obviously. So don't worry about it at all. I wouldn't just if it's helpful right now to drink two or three glasses a night, then do. And when it's less helpful, you won't need to. You won't become addicted to it. It's not going to cause you any problems. So as long as it doesn't make you want the real thing, then go ahead. I would. Did you finally put on weight? I did initially, which is a bugger, isn't it? Because you sort of think, God, I'm being so good, and I'm actually putting on weight. Drinking really messes up your metabolism. So when you stop drinking, it takes quite a long time for your metabolism to sort out. Plus, often you crave sugar. So I ate quite a lot of cake. But after about 100 days, it started shifting and I lost 2 stone. So don't worry about it. Weight, I think, is the least of your worries initially. Just eat what you need to eat to feel okay, and then you can deal with it further down the line. As I said, about 100 days is often when people find the weight starts to shift, and I did lose 2 stone without trying. So hopefully it will happen. Did you ever dream about drinking? Yes, I still dream about smoking as well. I gave up smoking about 15 years ago. I had a really vivid dream that I accidentally had a beer and I was really angry with myself. Even that's so common, Arwen. A lot of people have drinking dreams, that's just your subconscious being a nightmare. But isn't it great when you wake up and realize that you didn't really do it? So yeah, don't worry, it's quite normal. I felt terrible for the first 3 weeks, then came out the other side. This is Helen, now at day 54, and wake up shattered and with a headache. Is it PAWS? Yes, I write in the book about PAWS, PAWS, post alcohol withdrawal symptoms. I think it stands for, I can't remember now. Yes, it quite possibly is. You find that often for the up to the first year or even 2 years, you have these phases, a bit like PMT, where your brain chemistry is still adjusting, and you suddenly, having got easier, suddenly get difficult again. Again, it's perfectly normal. All you need to know is it's just a few days and it will go, and just hang on in there. And those periods get shorter and more manageable, and the time between them gets longer. So don't worry, it's perfectly normal. It throws a lot of people off balance initially, because you think, I was doing so well and now it's getting harder again. Don't panic. It happens to everybody. Sue, I love ginger cordial with soda. That sounds great. Thank you for that. So I think that's about it. But I will keep checking the thread on here. So do ask me any more questions. And you can get hold of me in all sorts of places. So I have a Facebook page called Sober Mummy, and I post helpful and inspirational stuff on there every day. And you can message me through there. And I have an Instagram page which you can message me through as well. And that's Claire underscore Pooley. You need the underscore, otherwise you get another Claire Pooley, and she's really fed up with everybody thinking she's next Lush. That's me, not her. So yeah, you can get hold of me on Instagram, and through my blog, obviously, Mummy Was a Secret Drinker. And my email is sobermummy@gmail.com. So do please, feel free to contact me. I always reply. It just sometimes takes me a while, but I will always reply. And thank you so much for listening. And I hope this has been helpful. And you're all great. So thank you. And good luck to everybody. You're doing a really amazing thing, and you should be really, really proud of yourselves. So crack open a bottle of whatever it is you now drink and give yourself a toast. You are amazing. Thank you. Bye bye.